This is part 5 of renal NGU disorders, and we're going to talk about a couple of congenital issues as well as circumcision. Initially, we're going to talk about hypospadias and epispadias, and basically what these are is the urethral opening is not located in the middle of the gland's penis. So hypospadias, the meatus of the urethra, is on the ventral surface, and epispadias, it is on the dorsal surface, or below and above. So below on the hypo and epi is above. There may be an absence of the ventral foreskin. There can be a fibrous band that causes the penis to bend on a permanent basis, and we call this a core D. On the newborn exam, urine flow may be in the wrong direction. So here are some pictures, and you have to look very closely at the one on the upper left, and you can see that the meatus is on the lower aspect of the gland's penis. And then the A, B, C, and D are a variety of other pictures of where the meatus is. On the bottom, we have two examples of a core D. When you look at the one on the far right, bottom right, you notice that the foreskin is present on the top of the penis, but it is absent on the lower aspect. Here's another picture of an epispadias. Here's a picture of a hypospadias. Sometimes these disorders are associated with the bladder being on the outside surface of the abdomen also. Here's another hypospadias. We actually found one of these when in OB in the fall. Here is a hypospadias along with a core D. And once again, you can see on the bottom, on the picture on the right, that the foreskin is absent. So what's important to remember is when we have this present, we don't do a circumcision because they may need to use the extra skin for reconstruction. We need to address the pre-op teaching and the fears that the parents have that this child isn't going to be normal. Postoperatively, there's a lot of education. And these procedures are now done on an outpatient basis. So we need to tell them to monitor for bleeding. There will be blood in the urine initially. This is expected, but it shouldn't continue to be profuse, and it should lessen with time. Monitor the child's urine output because there can be swelling and obstruction, so we want to make sure that we have an output. Monitor the circulation, so the color of the penis should be normal. Prevent infections, so at the surgical site, because they are going to go home with a catheter temporarily, we want to make sure that they clean it, because these kids, when they're repaired, many times they're still in diapers, so they need to cleanse the area. So what we have them do is double diaper, and one of them is going to be directed more towards stool to minimize exposure to the urethra, and then the other one is for the urine. And this would be especially true when that catheter is pulled. Many times these children are sent home with prophylactic antibiotics. We also want to tell the parents to avoid putting these children on a type of toy where they have to straddle a horse, a bike, or a scooter, that type of thing. The catheter, stent, or ileostomy care, if that's indicated, needs to be taught to the parents. The catheter is removed anywhere from 1 to 2 weeks post-op. There's no drainage bag for this catheter unless the child is older, in which case we're going to give them either the usual dependent bag or we'll give them a leg bag. And then the dressings are removed at 2 days post-op. The next problem that we encounter is what we call cryptorchidism, and what this is a testicle that is not descended. Make sure that you warm your hands before you examine the child, because cold hands will cause the scrotum to go up and you won't be able to palpate it. You can see in the picture that the testicles aren't fully into the scrotum, but at least they're not in the abdomen. We can get them between our fingertips. If it's fully in the abdomen, it's a different management. For the child that are in these pictures, we just give what I call tincture of time. Over time, they should descend into the scrotum. Now, the problem with cryptorchidism is the longer they stay in the abdomen with that increased heat, there's an increased risk of developing testicular cancer as well as infertility when the child is older. And so for that reason, when a child is admitted with testicular cancer, we ask in the history, did this child have undescended testicles at the time of their birth? We don't correct cryptorchidism until about 6 to 12 months of age, allowing time for them to come down naturally. This is now an outpatient procedure, and if you're really interested in watching how it's done, there's a YouTube video that you can just put in the search bar and you can watch it. We limit the activity for these little guys for about 3 or 4 days. We give analgesics. Tylenol or ibuprofen is adequate. But then we have to do discharge teaching to call if the temperature is greater than 100.5. If the child is complaining of increasing tenderness at the surgical site instead of decreasing, if the parents notice an increased swelling or redness around the incision, which could be indicative of infection, or if there's an unusual drainage or odor that's coming from it. So any unexplained pain, or if the child has nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, or constipation that is not getting better, they need to call the office or the clinic. Do remind the parents that there are doctors on call 24/7, 365. They don't have to wait until Monday morning if a problem occurs on Saturday or Sunday. The last thing that we're going to discuss is circumcision. What this is an elective procedure that's usually done immediately after birth. In the Jewish culture, circumcision is performed on the 8th day of life, and it is called a bris. The foreskin of the penis is surgically removed for hygiene purposes. For some circumcisions, it is done for cosmetic preference. The American Academy of Pediatrics is now in favor of circumcision to reduce the incidence of urinary tract infection. When the foreskin develops a narrowing and adhesions developed, a condition known as phimosis occurs, and you spell that phimosis. If this occurs, the child will have difficulty passing urine, and therefore at this point, circumcision becomes a medically necessary procedure. And do remember, the older the child, the more painful it is postoperatively. When we do a circumcision on the newborns, it's usually done within the first 2 days of life under a local anesthetic. It's the nurse's responsibility to place the baby on a circumcision board, and we restrain the upper extremities and lower extremities, or we just swaddle the upper extremities. You'll also be administering Sweeties, which is a sugar solution, and have the baby suck on a pacifier. The parents must be taught to apply gauze with a large dollop of Vaseline over the surgical site, and this prevents the diaper from adhering to the site, and they do this until it is fully healed. Circumcision will be discussed again in N174 because we'll be taking care of newborns. If we do a circumcision on an older patient and they have to remove Vaseline gauze, because we don't just use the 4x4 with Vaseline, we use the piece of tape type of Vaseline gauze, have the patient wrap the penis in warm washcloth that's moistened with warm water just to loosen a little bit, and then have them remove the gauze. Close the door, give them time, tell them to put the call light on if they can't do it at all or when they're finished. So this ends the lectures on genitourinary and renal disorders in pediatrics. Thank you for listening.